Okay, can you hear me?
Yes. Welcome to St. Stephen's United Methodist Church. We want to welcome all of you who are joining us online. We have several announcements today that I want to go through. Next Sunday is a very special Sunday here within our church. It is our Reconciling Sunday. We're going to be having three speakers who share their experiences and what they've gone through in their life. And I'm very excited to hear what they have to say and to really celebrate the openness and the affirmations of this church. This is a wonderful community of faith that speaks to so many people, not just, I find it interesting, not just here within this church, but it's interesting to see what we represent to other people as well. And so I think that's a great thing, and we're going to celebrate that next week. Also, starting next Sunday, the Reconciling Committee wants me to remind you that we are also beginning our AIDS Walk silent auction in the loggia. And so there will be items out there that you can put a bid on. And we're very excited about this. I said this last week. I'm going to say it again. One of the items that's going to be up to bid on is that you get to choose the sermon topic for your pastor for a Sunday. And so I would ask for a high bid and kindness and generosity in what you choose. Remembering that he's a little intimidated by that. So I hope everyone will come out and support this wonderful Sunday and that great event. So also next Sunday, we'll be giving our Bibles out to our third graders and honoring them as a church that welcomes and affirms who they are. And I think this is a very special event because I want to say that there's something incredible about a church that welcomes young ones in and says we are going to love and affirm not just who you are now, but who you grow to be. And I think that's an important statement because we know in this world that often what can happen is as we change and as we grow through and as we grow in life, people begin to erect walls and barriers towards us. That is not this church. This church says you're welcome and you're loved and affirmed at all times. And so I think that's a very special event. So also, we want you to put something on your calendar. Now, I talked about this in the first service. The Finance Committee is hosting a celebration. Now, I know what you're thinking. Sure. The Finance Committee never celebrates. We are having, on September 24th, a stewardship campaign potluck meal. And our stewardship campaign this year is going to be called Living the Vision and Growing Together. And I want you to know, yes, there will be some discussion about finances. And yes, there will be discussion about budgets. But it's also going to be a day of celebration. Because this church has so much to celebrate. So many wonderful ministries that we do. And we want to continue to do and even provide new opportunities into the future. I've already been talking to some of the staff about things they want to do in the future. And so we're going to be looking at some of those things. Where are we excited? What are we excited about already? What are we going to be excited about in the future? So come, be a part of that. There are sign-up sheets out in the loggia. You can sign up for a dessert, an entree, or a side item. Did I get that right?
Clean up setup.
That was the other one. Okay, so you can do any side, you can do any entree you want except sweet and sour meatballs because I took that one because it's the only thing I know how to make. So make sure you sign up. Also, Bell Choir starts this Wednesday night and also on Sunday. So if you are interested in that, make sure you talk to Marcy. Acolyte training will take place on Sunday, September 17th, immediately after the 10:50 worship service. And for more information, you need to talk to Jen McDaniel about that. And speaking of Jen, I wanted to share with you, she already knows I'm doing this, and she doesn't get embarrassed easily. As you all know, we have been on the search for a new children's ministry director. Jen has been filling in the interim in that position. You can now remove interim from her position and just call her the new children's minister of St. Stephen's United. And as a staff, Jen, we both welcome and fear your presence. So, we are very excited. So, are there any other announcements that I've missed? If not, let's... Oh, wait, Melissa?
No youth tonight.
Okay, no youth tonight, and then Benita, you had one.
Next Wednesday is the second Friday Indian Taco Dinner fundraiser at First American United Methodist Church. It's on Beaumont Street, close to Kennedy Elementary. Come and go, 11 to 2. It's their main fundraiser, and St. Stephen's is one of their main supporters. So, a lot of people will be there.
Friday.
What did I say?
Wednesday.
Friday.
It's on Friday.
Sorry.
Next Friday. So come and have Indian tacos. They are fantastic. So if there are no other announcements, let's begin our morning worship.
Please stand if you're comfortable and join me in the call to worship. And remain standing for our first hymn in the Black Hymnal 2171. God calls us to be people of the Spirit.
We are people of the whirlwind, riding fiery horses and chariots of fire.
God calls.
Oh, that's you.
Oh, I'll do that.
You do that.
God calls us to be heirs with Christ.
We are heirs of freedom, heirs of love that will not let us go.
God calls us to be children of the Most High.
We are children of promise, people of God's glorious hope.
Come, let us worship.
Thank you.
let's all join together in song, singing 2233, Where Children Belong, as our children come forward for this morning's sermon.
Friends. doing the things that friends do. Amen.
Amen.
So if you're, second and under, you can go to celebration with Miss Vicki, and if you're third or above, you can go back to your seats and stay for church.
Our scripture lesson today comes from Proverbs chapter 17, verse 9, and then from Paul's letter to the church in Galatia, chapter 5, verses 13 through 15. Hear these words. One who forgives an affront fosters friendship, but one who dwells on disputes will alienate a friend. And then from Paul's letter. For you are called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become slaves to one another. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. If, however, you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by one another. The word of life for today. Thanks be to God. I want you to remember this scripture over the course of the next few weeks. It's from the letter, Paul's letter to the Hebrews. And he says, therefore, we must pay attention to what we have heard so that we do not drift away from it. And that's going to be important because over the course of the next 4 weeks, we're going to be talking about the things that we drift away from in our lives, the things that we lose our focus on. And what happens is, in my belief, is that we become overwhelmed by other priorities in our lives, schedules, things that are going on, and slowly we begin to lose focus on what is important and cherished in our lives. And we need to heed Paul's challenge so that we don't begin to drift. We're going to look at what causes us to spiritually drift, and then we're going to look at how God calls us back to that which we hold as most sacred in our lives. Next week, we'll be looking at how culture and society often attempt to pull us away from the values that we hold sacred. Values such as compassion, justice, love, acceptance, and affirmation are beginning to wane in the face of a prevailing culture that calls for us to shift to attitudes of indifference, hatred, exclusion, and intolerance. In our third week, we're going to look at how, in the face of changing routines and schedules, we can slowly alienate ourselves from our churches and our communities of faith. And then in our final sermon, we're going to look at how easily we can become lazy in our spiritual disciplines, forgetting to pray, to read scripture, to meditate, to practice compassion towards others. Those disciplines that are essential to our faith and our relationship to God. But today, we're going to begin by looking at the ways we can drift away from the most fulfilling relationships in our lives. And this happens, you need to be clear. Relationships with siblings, parents, children, spouses, friends, and co-workers. These are cherished relationships because they define in part who we are. We're defined by the people we spend time with. We're defined by our relationships. And over a course of time, we can begin to lose contact with these people. And one of the interesting things is that we have to focus on what it means to be intentional in our relationships. And I'm going to speak about that a little bit more. But one of the things that I would tell you is that when my parents were still alive, I would call my parents so many times in a single day that my dad would often answer the phone with, "What?" You know, he was like, I was calling so much that he was like, "What do you want to talk about now?" And I said, "I don't understand why 5 times a day is a lot." You know, so many of you are saying, well, that is a lot. But that was the nature of our relationship. But what's interesting is since that time, as I've gotten married, and as now, you know, April is part of my life, and I'm a part of hers, and we're working working in the church and she's working in the hospitals, one of the things that we're having to learn to do is be more intentional in our relationships with our siblings. You know, I'm having to really work hard to remember to call my sisters and to stay in touch with them. And we're going to be talking about intentionality in this sermon. Paul challenges us to pay greater attention to these things so that we don't drift away. Now, let's think for a moment about how drift occurs in our lives. And I want to begin by saying that I don't believe that you wake up some morning and suddenly determine and say to yourself, that's it, that person's out of my life. Drift is not necessarily a conscious act. Now, I want to preface that also by saying that there are relationships in our lives that we do choose to end. Relationships that can be toxic and unhealthy, and that we need to cut out for our own spiritual well-being. But one of the things I would argue is that the sacredness of those relationships has usually ended long before we ever actually cut the strings. Generally speaking, however, when it comes to losing contact with those we hold dear, it is usually not an intentional action, but one that is gradual, that develops slowly over a period of time. Slowly our agendas and our priorities shift, and we place our most cherished relationships on the back burner. And I think we must do something to right the ship in drifting the waters. And as I said, it begins with intentionality. So let's look at what causes us to slowly drift away from others. Now, as I said, I don't think it's an immediate experience. Drifting away is slow and steady, takes place over a long course of time. But how does it happen? Why does it happen? And the reasons can vary. Perhaps there's an underlying current of conflict. Now, we all know the illustration of a duck on the water, right? It's very calm, very placid, moving along the water. But what's happening underneath? They're just paddling away, aren't they? Churning the waters. And I think that happens sometimes in our relationships. Disagreements begin to form between us and others. Disagreements over politics, religion, race, parenting styles, human sexuality, and so many other issues. And those differences can begin to foster resentments towards those we love. And slowly we begin to pull away from those relationships. We become angry at those we love, and gradually we become defensive. Pride steps in, and walls begin to be constructed. But King Solomon warns us in Proverbs when he writes, "One who forgives an affront fosters friendship, but one who dwells on disputes will alienate a friend." And so I ask yourself this question. Am I forgiving? Do I foster or do I dwell on the disputes I have with others? Now I know that in our own minds we're saying, oh yes, I'm a forgiving person. But it's interesting to think about whether or not you let certain disputes fester in your own subconscious. Are you really forgiving others or are you just suppressing those feelings? My guess is that all of us at different times have found us doing one or the other. We're guilty of both. Sometimes we forgive, other times we let those disputes fester until they infect everything about our relationships. Now, I believe that one of the things that often happens is that we begin to drift away because of environmental shifts, priorities, or life experiences. One of the most interesting things that happened to us recently through the COVID-19 pandemic was that we experienced a sense of isolation and loneliness. You saw people starving for community in new ways. And in some ways, we responded as a society very well. You know, we found new ways to communicate. I've always said this. I wish that I had bought stock in Zoom in 2018 or 19. That would be great. But I didn't do that. That had to be introduced to me. One of the things that happened is my little sister, she lives in a cul-de-sac, Megan does, and her and Joey didn't know their neighbors. And then one day they received a note on their door saying, we're going to all get together at the end of the cul-de-sac And so they took their cooler and their lawn chairs and they rolled up to the top of the cul-de-sac, and everybody sat about 20 feet apart, and they got to know their neighbors. And this became some of their most cherished relationships to this day. But for others, the pandemic resulted in massive isolation, fear, and loneliness. Other ways that other individuals we can drift away from is sometimes a result of generational conflicts. Parents and children can come into conflict as worldviews shift and families change, and this can cause separation. We can also drift away from our partners. Slowly, romance and the newness of our relationship fade. Pressures of finance, family, and work slowly take over, and we begin to neglect or take for granted that most sacred relationship. Friendships can change over time. Maybe a change in career or where you live has shifted the environment in which you live, and you find yourself drifting away from close friends. Now, I want to tell you something that's interesting for Methodist pastors in Oklahoma. We move quite a bit. And we move, you know, about every 4, 5, 6 years, depending upon everything. You move from one location to another, and you have to start over with new relationships. Now, that doesn't mean that you've lost the love for those other friendships that you had, but it means now, due to proximity, due to closeness and geography, the nature of the relationship has been changed. And that's true for all of us. We live in a world now where people move a lot. And so all of you have experienced this yourselves, those friends, those loved ones who are now far away. All of us at different times in our life have experienced that drifting away. But how do we become intentional in righting the ship? How do we rebuild our most sacred relationships? The Apostle Paul declares in Galatians, "For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters." And I have always thought that this statement is so true, especially in our society and culture. We choose so many things about our lives. We have the freedoms to do that. We choose our relationships in many ways. We choose whether or not to participate in them. We choose what we cherish. We choose our values. But Paul goes on to say this. He says, "Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence." Don't use your freedom to serve only your self-interest. And that's where the collision sometimes comes in. Because if ever we lived in a culture that said, "Observe your own self-interest," it's ours. Have you ever watched TV commercials? I love watching television, and I now you can sort of speed through them. But if you watch them, there's nothing in there, there's no commercial that says, "Take care of others first." All of them are pretty much about what is best for you, what you need, what you want. But Paul is challenging us, and he's saying, don't put yourself before others. Put their interests before your own. He says, through love, become slaves to one another. And this is the primary commandment of Christ. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. You shall look to serving, honoring, loving others as much as you do yourself. What does it look like for us to love others? To become a slave to those we love? For us to place others above ourselves and to make others a priority in our lives? And I want to challenge us to see that there are three things that we can do to drastically improve our relationship, to right that drift. First, encourage one another. Hebrews 3:13 says, "But exhort one another every day, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin." And I know what you're saying to yourself, because I've found myself saying it. You're saying, "I'm encouraging to those I love." But the question is, are we really? I encourage us to think about that. Recent studies say that one of the most important components of a successful relationship is encouragement. Do you find your relationships encouraging or discouraging? The reality is that many of us find within our relationships a high level of criticism. Have you ever thought about it? Are you critical to those you love? Or are you affirming? We often find that those we love can be highly critical of us, nitpicking of us, and we of them. Now, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands because I know who you're sitting next to. But think about that. Do you nitpick your partner, your children, your friends? Sometimes we do. Some of you are laughing at one another. That's how I know. So we think to ourselves, my loved ones, my partner, my children, my friends, they know I appreciate them. I don't need to tell them. But here's a question for you. Do you not need words of encouragement in your own life? Are you not starving at times for affirmation? If you are, then my guess is that so are your loved ones. Stop and follow Paul's command to encourage one another. Let them know they are loved and appreciated. Second, honor one another. Romans 12:10 declares, love one another with mutual affection and outdo one another in showing honor. This is critical. Honor demonstrates an appreciation so deep of others that you would rather see someone else succeed above yourself. Honor others by demonstrating your appreciation and going the extra mile in showing that appreciation. Now, I want to tell you a quick little story here. In one of my churches, I had a young lady named Morgan. And now Morgan is now a teacher and married and everything. But when she was in high school, she was known as the babysitter extraordinaire of Kingfisher, Oklahoma. If you hired Morgan to babysit, not only did she play with your children, she never turned on the TV, she played with them, cooked them dinner, then she cleaned the house top to bottom and was even known to prepare your meals for the week so that you didn't have to. Morgan had so many people asking her to babysit that her docket was just filled to the brim. I asked her to babysit. I don't have children, y'all. It was amazing, but Morgan was showing how much she appreciated others, and as a result, they honored her back. Lastly, forgive one another. Ephesians 4:31 says, put away from you all bitterness and wrath and anger and wrangling and slander together with all malice and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ has forgiven you. I think one of the problems that plagues our relationships is that we seek to get our own way in relationships. Sometimes we seek to turn others into carbon copies of ourselves. When it comes to the people we love, much of our plans involve fixing them to be who we'd like them to be. We want people to be like us. It's easier. If they do everything the way I would do it, would not the world be a better place? We have always said it. See, Jimmy agrees. And Jimmy, it's just everybody needs to know that Jimmy does it right. If all you all would just adapt, it would be fine. But the truth is that when people do not adapt to the way that we do things, we become angry and resentful, and we begin to see their resistance as a statement of what is wrong with us. And you know what that does? Now we're really mad. Because that's not what we want to hear. We don't want to hear that the way we do things is wrong. We want others to adapt. But we need to forgive one another and accept one another as we are. Don't let the little arguments or conflicts that arise in your relationship fester to infection. Instead, be, as Paul instructs us, be kind to each other, tender-hearted, forgiving one another. Each and every one of us has flaws, imperfections in our character and our actions. All of us have let a stray, harsh word or statement flow from our lips and pierce the hearts of those we love. But remember, someone, somewhere along the lines, has forgiven you, just as God, through Christ, has forgiven you. Friends, it is easy for us to drift away in our relationships. But God, through Christ, has given us the tools to restore our relationships, to readdress the drifting patterns in our lives that lead us out of focus on what is truly important.
Let us not drift aimlessly, but let us focus on encouraging one another, honoring one another, and forgiving one another, until we find ourselves headed in the right direction. If we practice these attributes in our lives, we may well discover that we feel these same things in our lives. We'll feel honored, forgiven, loved, and affirmed. We may experience the vitality and newness of our relationships and feel the joy of Christ in our hearts once again. In the name of the Creator and the Redeemer and the Sustainer, amen.
Next hymn, Spirit of the Living God, in the red hymnal, 393.
Life.
may be seated. I would invite everyone to remember the joys and the concerns that were lifted up earlier in our service. And if you are joining us online and you have a joy or concern that you would like to share, please privately message us and let us know, or you can call our church office and we'll add it to our prayer list. Let us pray. God of love, God of grace, and God of healing, we come to you today in celebration of the many blessings that we have in our lives. We thank you for new opportunities, new beginnings, and we thank you for this church and this community of faith. For you have given us a group and a family to lean on in difficult times. You've given us a family to celebrate with and a family to cry with. And so we thank you for the many ways in which you have enriched our lives. But we also come to you today lifting others up in our prayers. Those who are struggling with the loss of loved ones. Those who are experiencing poor health. We lift them up to you and we ask for your healing presence in their lives. Help them to know that you are there with them, granting to them love, affirmation, and grace. And God, we thank you so much that you have given us the opportunity as your followers to be in ministry to others, reaching out to them with love and understanding. For your Son, Jesus Christ, reached out to each of us and offered us a new direction in our lives. And so we give you thanks for his presence here within this place today and for his presence in our hearts and souls as we remember those we're praying for, praying the prayer that he taught his disciples to pray, saying, Great divine spirit of love that is at the core of everything and from which all life flows, we acknowledge your healing and transforming power. May the spirit of unconditional love and forgiveness flow through each of us and enable the realm of love to spread throughout the world. Like the flowers in the fields, ensure that we have the basics we need to live and to give us the love and courage to acknowledge when we have done wrong, to seek forgiveness from those we have hurt, and to forgive those who have hurt us, so that we may be reconciled. We acknowledge the power of self-giving love to transform individual hearts and the world. We recommit ourselves to the unconditional love of others and the work of justice and peace. Amen. This morning, as we prepare for communion, I want to remind everyone that ours is an open communion table, just as this is an open and loving and affirming church. This table is open and affirming of all who enter. So we want to invite everyone to be a part of communion and to partake of the elements.
I'd like to invite everyone to turn to number 2257 in your black hymnal to join me in the communion responses there.
Turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast.
You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, who looked for that day when justice shall roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, when nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Serve to come forward at this time.
The table has been prepared. Come as you feel led by the Spirit of God. The bread of life, take and eat. The cup of the new covenant, take and drink. Brothers and sisters, would you rise? My friends, as we go forth from this place, let us go in peace, knowing that there are disputes among us at times, but we have been given the gifts of reconciliation with others. We have been shown how to practice forgiveness, how to practice honor and love and affirmation. So as we go forth from this place and encounter others in the world, let us go with the peace and the grace of Christ upon our hearts. And as the people of God, let us go in peace. Amen.
Yeah, aren't the kiddos great?
Oh, I love it!
I'll just leave it.